Hello, everyone. Welcome to our PBS Kids Building Relationships Virtual Professional Learning Series for Teachers.
This is the third webinar on social emotional learning from PBS Education. This year, PBS Education is offering several series of virtual professional learning led by teachers like us who are using PBS resources in their classroom. PBS Kids programs have always been the place for kids to find examples of how to make their way in the world, not just in terms of academic knowledge and curiosity, but in terms of intersocial challenges, stumbles, and recoveries along the way. In recent years, with the advent of teaching science, the science around social-emotional learning, PBS programs has folded that science into their productions. This is exemplified by recent seasons of Arthur and Sesame Street, and of course, the advent of Daniel Tiger's Neighborhood. Today, we're going to meet Julie and me, two teachers who are putting PBS Kids assets to work in their classrooms, not just to cover the SEL requirements, or to make their classroom lives better, but to impart skills and knowledge for the wider world. And then we're also going to get to hear from Alexandra Cassell. She's a supervising producer at Nine Story Media Group and a writer and story editor on Daniel Tiger's Neighborhood. We're gonna ask her to reflect upon what she's heard from Julie and I and how we may be able to construct a virtuous circle where PBS Kids content helps educators and educators in turn inform the content producers about what's working in our classrooms and what's needed next. And we'll be sure to save some time for Alexandra to give us a sneak peek about what's coming up in Daniel Tiger's Neighborhood. Today's session goals are to explore strategies that can be used to help early learners build good neighbor skills and create an atmosphere of respect within the classroom. We're also going to focus on learning from the expertise of experienced educators and get some practical classroom-tested strategies and real-world stories of trial, error, and success. This is one of my very favorite Mr. Rogers quotes. There is something for yourself. There is something of yourself that you leave in every meeting with another person. And I think that's an amazing quote.
I think that that's going to work well for us tonight. I hope that we can all leave something with each other as we work through this VPLS together. A couple of housekeeping things. We're using OV tonight. There is a chat box that you can use to introduce yourself. We hope that you will. You can post any comments and submit questions, which we'll be sure to look through tonight and answer as many as we can. There are also emojis if you'd like to share your feelings, which is very SEL. This webinar will be about an hour long. If you have any technical issues or concerns, please reach out to ov@itvs.org. For best results, you want to connect your computer to a hardwired internet connection and use Chrome browser. If you experience any issues, you can always refresh your screen and see if that helps. We're excited about tonight.
My name is Michelle Garmon, and I am a first grade teacher from Rio Rancho, New Mexico, and I'm really excited to take part in this. This year, my classroom focus has been putting social emotional learning across content and adding a little bit of just that social emotional talk throughout my day, and I'm really excited to learn from Julie and Alexandra tonight, and I'm so glad you're all here to ask questions and answer mine too.
And I'm Julie Hildebrand. I'm a first grade teacher here in Austin, Texas. I'm also our campus innovation coach. In addition to that, I'm a PBS Digital Innovator All-Star, which led me to getting to be a part of this great VPLS. I am also a Heart of Texas Writing Project Teacher Consultant, and I do some education consulting for the Ready to Learn Initiative and for Rosen Publishing. And we're gonna introduce our awesome guest, and that is Alexandra Cassell. And Michelle touched on her accolades just a bit. She is the supervising producer at Nine Story Media Group. She is also the writer and story editor on Daniel Tiger's Neighborhood, and she's the author of over a dozen children's books that are related to the show and have been published by Simon & Schuster.
That's awesome. Today, and just like the other two VPLS social emotional learning webinars that have taken place in the last couple of weeks, we're going to focus our learning just around this CASEL wheel. CASEL stands for the Collaborative for Academic, Social, and Emotional Learning. And CASEL's goals are to help make evidence-based social and emotional learning an integral part of education from preschool through high school. With the CASEL core competencies, educators have a framework, which is what this wheel is here. The other webinars focused on self-management, self-awareness, and responsible decision-making. Today, we're going to focus on building relationships in those early classroom years. So the relationship skills basically are the ability to establish and maintain healthy, rewarding relationships. And this is really tricky in early childhood classrooms because we know developmentally there's that fine line between I am the queen of everything and now I need to share things. So building relationships is pretty tricky. And Julie, I think you have a great lesson coming up to help show us that.
I do. So this slide just shares a little bit more about what relationship skills pertains to, but it's, you know, that idea of really fostering communication, social engagement, relationship building, and teamwork. And so the activities that we're going to share with you tonight really highlight ways that you can foster those relationships in your classroom. And the activity that I want to share with you is something that I did in my classroom recently, and I used these Life's Little Lessons. It's a collection of fun and flexible resources that were designed for early childhood care providers, and you can find it on PBS Learning Media. There's a whole collection of them, lots of things that you can use in your classroom. But it's based on the PBS Kids show, Daniel Tiger's Neighborhood, and it uses this model of watching a video, playing a game or interacting in some way, exploring in a group or with peers, and then also sharing, communicating that learning with families. So I just took a lesson. It's written out for you. So it's step by step. It even gives you time fragments. So it's really well built. And I showed that. And then I had my kids get on Seesaw and talk about how they are alike and different with each other. So I think we'll get started with watching the Daniel Tiger video. And then I'll show you what it looks like in my classroom.
I'm the sheriff.
Sheriff, is there a problem?
I'm just making sure that everyone is safe. That's my job. Cause I'm the sheriff.
Hey, Chrissy.
Right. And I'm the cowgirl. Yeehaw!
You do both love to pretend together.
Hey, that's something that's the same. Daniel, you like to pretend too. Oh, yeah. I do like to pretend too. That's the same. But I still have a tail and nobody else does. So I'm still really different.
I'm different too. I wear these braces on my legs to help me walk. And I use these crutches too. That's different. And people see it. But it's one of the things that makes me me.
But it's not the only thing. There are a lot of things that make you who you are. There is only one person exactly like you.
If we were all the same, that would be no problem.
Let's take a picture of the way you two are different, because I think it's something exciting.
I want to be different too, Toots. I like being different. I know, my skin is different from Chrissy's.
Good observation, Miss Elena.
My skin is brownish.
Oh, yeah, and mine is more pinky.
Your skin is different than Chrissy's. In some ways we are different, but in so many ways we are the same. I know someone who has the same skin color as you. Me!
Oh, yeah! And I have a tail, don't forget. That's different, too. Hey, Prince Wednesday and I have something that's different too. Our hair. Mine's curly and black, and Prince Wednesday's is straight.
And brown.
And my hair is, well, my hair's fur,
and it's stripey.
Will you take a picture of all our sames and differences, please?
Okay, sure.
I feel happy. I feel happy too.
Me too.
See? Your feelings are the same sometimes too. Like now, you're all
happy.
Wow, our whole class is the same and different.
In some ways we are different, but in so many ways we are the same.
Watch Daniel Tiger's Neighborhood weekdays on your PBS.
So if you watch the whole video, Daniel Tiger is a little uncertain about this new and different person. And so they do a whole lesson on how they're similar and how great it is to be special and unique, but how similar we really all are. And so I wanted to highlight that in my classroom. And I paired up my kids and I had them get on Seesaw, which is a digital portfolio that you can have your kids post work to, and you can comment on their work. Their parents can see it like immediately as soon as something is posted, and you have control over anything that's posted, so it's very, very safe. So they all got on Seesaw and did this Venn diagram activity where they shared with their buddy how they were like their buddy and different. And it was really neat to see how they lit up when they realized how similar they really were, but also how special and unique they were as well. So I think we'll show what this looked like in the classroom next.
All right, so this morning we're gonna be talking a little bit about how we are all similar and how we are all different. And we're gonna start by watching a video of when Daniel Tiger meets a new friend, Chrissy, who is Prince Wednesday's cousin. They decide to attend play night in Prince Wednesday's castle, which is his bedroom. And Daniel learns that Chrissy has leg braces to help her walk, and that he really has fun playing. And you're going to go into activities. When you get to activities, you're going to do the very first one. Same, same, but different. Add that to your name. I'm just gonna add it to mine. And then you and your buddy are gonna decide who's in one circle and who's in the other circle. You're gonna be putting things that are the same in the middle and things that are different about you in each of your own circles. All right, I need a minimum of two in the middle, two things that are the same, and two things that are different in the outside circle. If you can do more, awesome. And I need a minimum of two. So you and your buddy, you're going to have to talk about and think of ways that you're similar and ways that you're different. You might want to talk about your families or things that you like to do or ways that you appear. You can use any of those in your Venn diagram. When you and your buddy are finished, Xander, you can save it to Seesaw with the green check. And then if you have extra time, you can get on Seesaw and draw a picture of your family so we can see how all of our families look differently. Okay, but first you have to do your Venn diagram with your buddy, and then if you have extra time, you can get your own device and draw on Seesaw a picture of your family.
Yeah. We don't need it. What do you
mean? That computer isn't
playing video games. So how about this? So we both like playing video games, so that means they know it's yours. You write them all right.
You are best friends. All right, can you have something different between the two?
I am.
four. Very good. All right. Violet, what's something that you and Ruby had the same?
Brown eyes.
You both have brown eyes. Ruby, what's something that y'all had different? You had different clothing.
We both have hair.
You both have hair. Excellent. And Jay, what's something different between you two? Your skin color is different. Excellent. All right. Dika, what was something that you and Finbar had the same? You both love s'mores. Awesome. Anything you want to share about your family?
I am different colors, but it doesn't matter. My family is important because we're all one family.
Absolutely.
They absolutely loved talking about themselves. And so this was just such a wonderful activity to let them do that and really connect with each other. If you haven't used Seesaw before, I would highly, highly recommend checking it out. It's very user-friendly. And you teach the kids one time how to log in, and then they're going to be teaching you how to use it pretty quickly and all the neat features on it. Were there any questions about the activity or about Life's Little Lessons? Like, if there are any questions yet? But if you have any, go ahead and post them in the chat box, and we're happy to answer them. We do have a couple of other PBS resources that we wanted to share if you wanted to do more on relationships. If you go to PBS Learning Media, there is a ton of different resources that you can access for free and utilize in your classroom. If you go to the next slide, there's a couple that we have listed. So Funny, I Forgot to Laugh, which we highlighted in one of the earlier VPLSs. Peg Plus Cat has a You Can Count on Me. There's a Daniel Tiger's Tea Party game as well. So really lots of activities that you can use in place of a video or to even extend it further. But I think we're gonna pass it over to Michelle and let her share her activity.
Thank you, Julie. And I do love that Daniel Tiger video so much. I was singing along. That's great. As I was saying earlier, building relationships in the early classroom setting is pretty difficult to negotiate. And I know that one of the most effective strategies that I found as a first grade teacher is modeling. And I do a lot of thinking out loud. For example, today I said, "Boys and girls, wow, I had such a sad lunchtime today. Miss Tafoya ate lunch with Mrs. Madrid today, and I didn't get to eat lunch with her. And I felt like my stomach hurt and my heart was beating really fast, and I even got a little bit sweaty. And I just was really, really, really upset about it. But then I remembered that it's okay to have a lot of friends. And I went across the hall and I sat with Miss Evenbergen, and she and I had a great time having lunch. And then I went to the playground and we all got to play together. So I do a lot of that kind of talking out loud so that the kids not only have names for what they're feeling or what different strategies that they can use. I do a lot of storytelling, and I ask the students a lot of times to kind of share if they've ever felt that way, or what are some of the strategies that you use to help you when you're feeling a little bit sad, or maybe you're a little upset, or when you have to share a toy, or when maybe you have a conflict with a friend. So part of building relationships is keeping those relationships. And in the early years, we do see a lot of conflicts pop up. So one of the lessons that I like to do every year is have the students in my class write a story, sharing one of the conflict strategies that they use. So it could be maybe you could take a turn, or maybe you could make a deal and share whatever is happening, or talk it out, or find somebody else to play with. So one of the neat ways that I use PBS Learning is Scratch Junior. In my classroom, we have play pads that have PBS Scratch Junior, which is a really fun storytelling coding app. So in the clip here, you're going to see me setting up the lesson that is pretty exciting, if the clip works.
All right, boys and girls, today is a super exciting day. Today, we are going to make our stories come to life. This week, our learning goal has been, I can find a way to play together. We've been talking about conflicts. When you have a conflict with a friend, there are a lot of different things that we can do to find a way to play together. Raise your hand if you know one. What's one way? You could share a ball. What else could you do?
You could share a toy.
Sure, you could share. Could you take turns?
Yeah.
Yeah, you could take turns. Could you talk it out?
Yeah.
Yeah, those are all different strategies that we've been talking about in class. You've written your stories. Today, you and your learning partners are going to use our playpads and PBS Scratch Junior to code those stories. You get to pick your characters and your background. And when you're all done with your stories, I want you to trade devices so that you can share your stories. Thumbs up if that sounds good. All right, friends, find your learning partners and get to work. I'll be right there.
Does she look good?
Yeah.
So you can see that the students really enjoyed using that coding application, but what they didn't see was that they were modeling for each other the different strategies that we had been practicing in class. Now, of course, you don't need to have a coding app to retell stories. You can just even write books and trade the books and get the same lesson that way. But I just really love that the kids had a hand in teaching each other the different strategies, and Scratch Junior just made it that much more exciting.
It looks like we have a couple of questions that have popped up. Okay. I guess one of them, this probably relates to life's little lessons, is could this work for toddlers, and how would you adjust the lesson to them? So actually the life's little lessons are made for some younger kiddos, and I just adjusted it to work for first graders by integrating technology and Seesaw into it, but they are built for younger grades. And then we also had, what is the time frame for lessons? So many times we're really limited on getting to do extra things. And it's kind of make it what you want. You can show a whole video of Daniel Tiger, that's about 12 minutes. Or if you just want to show like the little clip that we showed, that was less than 3 minutes, and just have a discussion around it. It doesn't have to be a full production. You just make it what you need. Did you have any advice to go with that, Michelle?
Sure. I was going to share that on PBS Learning Media, there are clips listed under the Daniel Tiger category that are just even a minute long. You can also use the Daniel Tiger Parents app, which is a really great resource. And that's just got little clips of songs. And all I have to do in my classroom is sing, "Find a Way to Play Together," and the kids sing it back and it diffuses. So that's a really great tool.
Yeah. One of the other questions are the units and lessons sequential, where you can teach them all year long, and how often are you teaching? I know in my classroom, we spend a good 6 weeks at the beginning of the year setting up this idea of community and working together and feeling like one cohesive group. And then I'll pepper it in throughout the year if I see that there's a need for whatever it may be, then I'll find an extra lesson to throw in to to help our community continue to grow. Michelle, what do you do?
The Life's Little Lessons categories are set up by different situations. It could be a conflict, or it could be making friends, could be different social emotional learning skills. So if you see the need for a different lesson, or you see that your classroom might benefit from some relationship building, for instance, you can just go and search that way. I think that the castle wheel is a circle for a reason. I think things kind of come up. We don't learn how social emotional learning doesn't go sequentially. It kind of evolves into itself. So I would just watch your students and kind of pick up what you're hearing. Listen to those conversations and do a search that way.
Yeah, next question is, any advice for schools that are not allowed to use technology? There's so many books made that relate to Daniel Tiger's Neighborhood and other PBS media that you could easily, you know, grab one of those and read that. And it's the same as content, just in a different format.
Sure. I would even like think about story starters and or just sit down and have a classroom meeting and say, boys and girls, you know, last night this happened to me and I got my feelings hurt. Do you have any ideas about what I can do? And just kind of pull from what they already know. I think that's a great way.
Yeah, I think we should segue into speaking with Alexandra.
Hey. Hi, happy to be here.
So excited to have you. Thank you for joining us tonight. I think we have a couple of questions for you, and then if the audience has any, please keep posting those in the chat box, and we'll get as many answered as we can. Michelle, did you want to start on?
Yes, I would love to. Alexandra, what do you think of the activity that you've seen from Julie and I so far? And I try to tie my lessons into Daniel Tiger. I'm a big Mr. Rogers fan. How do you think they tie into what Daniel Tiger is all about?
I mean, it's first of all, just amazing to see the outreach that's happening. Our goal, you know, is to reach these 2 to 5 year olds. So I love the question about, is this applicable for older or younger age groups? Because even adults are using these strategies. So yes, I love that the lessons that we're planting seeds in the littlest viewers are applicable at every grade. And I love to see the ways that you guys are using technology or not to make that happen. Yeah.
Awesome. What extensions do you see coming from this work into the larger school climate, into homes, into communities? How is this, can this be used outside of what we're doing?
Yeah, I mean, the fact that you've even invited me to be part of tonight's event, you know, our creators are constantly trying to have an open dialogue with educators. So we'd love to be doing even more of that so we can learn from each other. I attended NACI in DC recently. Like, we really do love to hear what's going on in classrooms because, you know, that's where we want to meet kids where they're at. We do have our own research process where we take a paper version of each script into JCCs and other centers around where we are. But, you know, you're in Texas and all over the world, really. We'd love to be hearing from educators everywhere to make sure that our lessons are resonating. And, you know, just recently we asked teachers, what other strategies could you use in your classrooms? Like, we're trying to create an arsenal of tools that parents at home and educators in classrooms can be using. And we want to find out if there are any challenges that you're facing that you don't feel you have that Daniel Tiger episode for just yet. So recently a teacher told us transitions was particularly hard for her, switching from one point of the day to the next, and how to deal with self-control and things like that, or when things don't go as planned, how to pivot. So that's something that we kind of dove into this season. So yeah, we're just constantly keeping the doors open and want to make sure that we're serving our population best.
Well, that's awesome.
I think that transitions is really important. That's something that, you know, we see a lot in the classroom, like when we're coming back from school and transitioning from summer, and even when we're transitioning back into summer, it's really hard for the kids to go through the different shifts of routine.
Or even different times during the day.
Yeah.
Different times during the day things happen.
Mm-hmm. So spoiler alert, that's what my sneak peek clip is about.
Oh, yeah.
And then
On the next question, we were going to ask about what challenges you encounter when trying to create content and deliver those messages to young people and the people that care for young people.
So I like the last part of your question, the people that care for young people. That I think is the challenge, because our goal is always to serve the kid. So we're constantly working on the language and everything to make sure that a 2 to 5 year old is understanding it. And oftentimes we find ourselves crafting a message that's really more for the adult. So for instance, listening is a huge one. Parents are asking us, like, where is the Daniel Tiger song about listen to me? And we've sat down a number of times with child development experts who say, your kid is listening to you, they're just not obeying you. And so the strategy jingles that we've come up with are really more for like tactics that the adult should be using to get through to their child. But that's not really our show. Our show is like, what are the jingles that we can be giving to kids? We love that adults are figuring out ways to use the strategies themselves or with their kids. But that, I would say that's the challenge, is like when you're really trying to help parents parent. But that's kind of like the side effect. And our main goal is to reach the child.
Are there any Daniel Tiger, or I'm sorry, from the viewers, are there any Daniel Tiger videos that discuss bullying?
Yes, I wrote one. Okay, that actually answers the last question too. It's very tricky for us to tackle content like bullying, like nightmares, where inadvertently you may be introducing a behavior or a fear that you don't, that a kid might not have already thought of on their own. So bullying was a particularly hard one for us, because I think, yes, even in preschools, you're seeing the beginnings of it. But we wouldn't want to show Daniel acting in a way, you know, we wouldn't want to model that behavior in order to kind of prevent it, because you always run the risk that what you're showing might be stickier or more repeatable than the resolution. So the one way that we did it so far, or not the one, but the one that's coming to mind for me, was kind of a take on Don't Yuck My Yum. So, you know, we always do a two-part episode. And in the first, Daniel brought a kind of stinky lunch to school, and Miss Elena mocks him for it, or kind of like says, oh, why are you eating that? I would never eat that. And so that was like a kind of subtle nod to when another friend makes fun of you or puts you down for something that you enjoy. And so we gave Daniel kind of the words to use to speak up for himself in that situation, which was, we can all like different things. That's just fine. Just remember to be kind. I think kindness is a theme that runs through most of our episodes. And so I would say that the series as a whole is kind of countering bullying. We just haven't really ever said like, you're bullying me, or shown kind of aggressive behavior that way. But there are a number of episodes, like It's Not Okay to Hurt Someone, the almost hitting kind of, we never show the actual push or shove, but the kind of body language that gets to just that point that we were comfortable showing before talking about how to calm yourself down.
I think we would love to see what you have coming up on transitions. Can we move into that?
Yeah, please. Just to set this up, yeah, it's not a particularly exciting clip, but I think it will be a very relevant or relatable one for the educators in the room. But basically, the kids are just feeling super excited, and we're giving them tools to calm down, to move on to the next activity. And I think the reason that this is so socio-emotional, even though it might seem more of like an individual self-control lesson, is because your behavior has an impact on the rest of the class. So that's what you'll see here.
Eating delivery soon! Oops! Oh. Hi, Teacher Harriet.
Class, I have some special news. Please clean up and come join me on the rug.
Okay.
Yes, yay!
Oh, I know what it is. Let's clean these blocks up fast. Speedy delivery! Ba-da-dum-ba-dum. Making another speedy delivery.
Zoom.
Come on. Oops. Speedy delivery. Speedy delivery. Speedy.
Katarina and Daniel, your friends are waiting to hear the big news. It looks like you're a little too excited to clean up.
Yes, Meow Meow, I am excited.
Let's try to calm down. Try this. Give a squeeze, nice and slow. Take a deep breath and let it go.
Give a squeeze, nice and slow. Take a deep breath and let it go.
Thank you both. Do you think you can finish cleaning up now so you can join the others on the rug?
Yes, I can, Meow Meow.
Me too.
Here we go. Here's one more. Done.
Class, today Miss Elena's dad, Music Man Stan, is going to make some music with us.
Ooh. My daddy's coming!
Music!
And now that everyone is calm, we are going to make our own musical instruments.
Oh, goody!
Tiger-tastic!
Yes!
I love that!
So you'll notice the time code was still on screen because we're still working on it, but there's a lot to unpack in there. We love using Teacher Harriet as like our exemplar teacher, which I'm sure some educators find totally infuriating that she just knows how to calmly handle every situation. But, you know, I think it's really helpful to have some verbiage to use in your own day to day, and even her body language. We're paying attention to all of those subtleties of taking a knee, getting on the kids' level, eye contact, you know, all those good things. So a lot in that clip.
Yes. We definitely need to train a lot of Teacher Harriet in the classroom. I had a question. What would we be surprised to know about what goes into the making of a Daniel Tiger episode?
The surprise. I would say most people are surprised to hear that it takes about a year from the scripting of an episode to when you finally see it on TV. Is that where you were going with this question, maybe? And that's partially because, especially in the kids' world, we have so many stakeholders and child development experts weighing in on just about every draft of every script or animatic, which is like our stage of animation. And we just want to make sure that what we're putting out in the world is wholesome and that we're doing good work and that we're, that we're being really effective.
We appreciate all the research. You know, as a digital innovator, I've had the opportunity to hear a couple of different producers from PBS Kids speak, and it's really incredible the process that you all go through with researching and field testing and, you know, it's all such wonderful work. So we appreciate everything that you're doing.
The mindfulness that goes into just developing the characters. Daniel Tiger's mom is like a hero. I love that she's so calm and that she's patient and that she's got more than one kid and that she's still happy and smiling. And of course, Daniel Tiger's teacher is just like a role model for all of us, I think. Just the mindfulness that has to go into that, I'm sure takes time.
Definitely. We always joke about that one breakdown episode where mom just takes out the bottle of wine and can't do it anymore. No, I'm just kidding. But I said, every detail of the dialogue that they're using, their body language, it's all very intentional and I would say effective. I hear a lot from parents. Like I said, the goal of our show is really to help the child. But we do hear inadvertently that parents feel like they're better parents after watching the show, or likewise, teachers feel like they're being better educators just because we're giving them a toolkit to use. So that makes me feel good.
True. Another question. Has there ever been a situation where you remember where the problem was stickier than the resolution in an early draft of the script and you had to adjust it?
Oh, that's a good question. Yes. So many times. Let me think. We recently introduced Jody's new family. I don't know if you guys are familiar with her yet, but she has two twin brothers, and we thought that would finally be our opportunity to show some behaviors that we wouldn't necessarily be comfortable showing Daniel engage in, but because the little ones are so much younger, maybe we could get away with it and be able to talk about, they're younger, they don't know just yet. So biting, we attempted to do, but we still just felt like that was introducing a potentially sticky behavior and didn't feel comfortable going there. So I don't think you'll see a biting episode anytime soon.
Let's see, what about, how do you decide which skills or concepts get developed into apps? There's a lot of PBS apps that, you know, are out there. Which ones are chosen to move forward with?
I can't speak so much to that. I don't really work on the digital team, but I would imagine that they're hearing a lot from you guys and what you want. I know that they're doing a ton of analytics to see what episodes are the most popular, what characters are the most popular, and just following fans and seeing what appeals and what is needed.
This one came up earlier. What's the best way to incorporate Daniel Tiger lessons without the use of technology in the preschool classroom? Did you have anything to add to that one?
I think you guys were really onto it. I mean, as I was watching yours, I imagine that using an iPad or all of these cool tablets that you have in classrooms these days makes the activity more fun for the kids. I know it would have made my education more fun if we had that. But just about everything I saw could have been done on paper. So, I mean, I was blown away to see that your kids are already typing so well, but they really could have been drawing Venn diagrams and all those activities. So I would say everything's pretty adaptable without the tech. And like you said, just a ton of, we've got the Daniel Tiger books and even, you know, this all stems from Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, which was a puppet show in essence. So even without showing clips of the show, like acting it out with Daniel plush dolls, there's just a number of things you could do low tech.
Yeah, it actually made me think of my daughter. I have a 3-year-old who's very into Daniel Tiger. And I got her a little Daniel Tiger's trolley from Amazon that came with Daniel Tiger and his mom. And then her little neighbor has all the little figurines, and they just love to play with them. So that would be something you could easily do in a preschool room, is just bring the little characters and let them act out the different situations.
Or even make their own puppets. I think that would be great. And then they could voice their own. And that would go back to the modeling that we were talking about earlier. Just model your thinking out loud and give the kiddos an opportunity to do the same thing.
Mm-hmm. And I will just add, I'm very excited to say this. We're working on a new plan and playbook, which is something that Fred Rogers developed for Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, so that there were activity suggestions to pair with certain episodes. I'm getting a little bit of feedback. And so we are actually working now with the Fred Rogers Productions team to develop a sort of plan and playbook for Daniel Tiger. So you'll have a whole bundle of ideas.
Oh, that's exciting.
Yeah, very cool. Somebody asked, are there actual Daniel Tiger puppets available?
I bet you there are. I'm sitting in my office and looking around right now. Yes, I think so. Yeah,
sure. Amazon,
definitely plush, definitely bath toys. I'm pretty sure they're hand puppets.
Are there any episodes dealing with divorce?
That is an interesting one. So we've talked about it. Again, I feel like a lot of the conversation ends up being more for the parent than for the kid. But as you might have noticed, we try to keep our neighborhood of make-believe very diverse. And I'm not just talking about the mix of humans to animal ratio, although there's that, but different family makeup. So we've never said where Katarina's father is or where Jody's father is, where Ovi Owl's parents are. He lives with his uncle. So we purposely leave those kinds of family makeups open-ended so that kids at home can see themselves reflected on screen and you know, see that like families can exist in a number of shapes and forms, and that love is all that matters. So we haven't tackled divorce just yet, but it's come up in brainstorms, and I'm sure that in a future season, maybe we'll go there.
Definitely a hard one to tell. This is a good question. They say they love your nail polish, Alexandra. The color.
I was saying the camera on this laptop is here, so I can't not show you my hands. It's called lilacism. Very important question.
That's fantastic. All right. Here's a question. I mean, dealing with the kid that's a perfectionist and often gets aggravated, is there anything that you think could aid in helping with that?
Sorry, can you repeat the question? I didn't hear the beginning.
All right. A child who's a perfectionist and often gets aggravated. Do you have any episodes that come to mind to manage that?
Totally. So first of all, the character that comes to mind for me is the owl. He's definitely a rule follower. And there's a jingle, things may change, and that's okay. So we can do things a different way that we're actually revisiting this season to see it applied in different contexts. But I think that that lesson applies to just about anything. So even if it's something super granular and small, like your block tower keeps crashing down, let's put it in something else. Or if the library closed and we need to divert this whole class field trip somewhere else, you know, on a bigger scale. So that one comes to mind for sure.
Very cool. Someone asked about your background and your past work. How's that inform your script writing?
So I studied child development. I got my master's from Columbia University, and I also studied media studies undergrad at Colgate. So those two kind of mesh perfectly to land in children's media. And I've actually been working on Daniel Tiger since the very beginning as the script coordinator back in season one. So I've kind of just grown with the show, and they call me Jukebox because I know every detail of every show.
Are there any stories or songs that will help a pre-K child to use words rather than cry? That one that comes to mind is "When You Feel So Mad That You Wanna," or too many others that you recommend.
I think we've done just about every emotion that you can name. If you guys have more, please let me know. But also, the first one that came to mind is "Use Your Words." Use your words to say how you feel. We kind of used Daniel's grrring in place of crying. He just keeps grr, and his friends can't figure out what is the problem. So we encourage him to talk it out. The only way we can help you is if you use your words.
There's any episodes that deal with death. I don't know if that relates back to your concerns of, in, you know, putting in a fear that it may not happen.
I do. I'm surprised you haven't seen it yet. It aired this year. We actually were just nominated for an Emmy based on that episode submission. Daniel's fish dies, which is very one-to-one with the episode it was inspired by on Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, where Fred's fish died. And it's really interesting. We were particularly nervous to take that episode into testing. As I mentioned much earlier in this session, we test all of our episodes in preschools and daycare centers. And we had parents and educators signing permission slips and warning them, like, if your kid comes home traumatized, here's why. But we were pleasantly surprised that kids were kind of like, okay, like, that's what it is. And I mean, as you guys know, working with kids, they're very literal. And if they haven't had this experience happen to them yet, it's kind of just like, these are the facts. The fish isn't breathing anymore. But then again, we have heard from fans saying, you know, they've dealt with death on either from a pet or a family member on a real big scale, and that the episode helped. So I think it was making that leap that we hoped it would. And basically it's so hard. Like, even as adults, we sat around the table and didn't quite know what strategy to come up with in that scenario. But we landed on ask questions. It might help. And I think for kids, you know, just giving them the time to process this information, ask the questions, tell them that they're, you know, that this is all natural and normal and their feelings. A quote that I love from Fred Rogers is, feelings are mentionable and manageable. So just being able to say how you're feeling, that's, you know, that's important too. Just yeah, giving them the space to do that.
I agree. Oftentimes they just don't have the right words to say what exactly. It is that they're feeling. Let's see. Do you have any advice on how to help children with autism with social skills in the classroom? Anything that you would suggest?
Okay, so again, this was not one of our goals, but inadvertently, we are hearing a ton from parents and caregivers of children on the spectrum that the series as a whole is helping them tremendously. And I think it's not surprising because we take the time to slowly break down social skills and emotions, and that's the thing that so many kids on the spectrum are challenged with. So, you know, just the pacing of the show and taking the like even in the clip you saw earlier about Chrissy's braces, in the earlier part of that episode, we took the time to stop. Can I touch them, ask questions about them? Like, what other show does that? And for kids on the spectrum, that's the way to get through to them. So the series as a whole, for sure. And then this is kind of confidential, but we are exploring tackling autism in a more concrete way on the show. So we'll have even more poignant strategies, I would say.
Very cool. Mm-hmm. Do you have an episode or a jingle to encourage a student to stay on task?
Okay, I'm thinking. Stay on task. Yes, we recently did Enjoy the Wow That's Happening Now. I don't think it's aired yet. Should be airing soon. But basically mindfulness for kids and focusing on what's the enjoyment of this thing you chose to do right now and stop worrying about the 100 things that you could be doing next. And I think that's so important for this generation who can be so easily distracted. And so, yeah, I would say enjoy the wow that's happening now.
I love that. That's a good one. A public librarian says she has a weekly class where her kids range from 5 to 12. They don't always have the same kids. Any suggestions for that type of setting?
I don't know. Sorry, so in terms of activities, is that the question?
I guess so, activities or maybe, yeah. Let's go with activities.
That's quite the age range. That's hard to please everybody all at once, I would say. I don't know. I kind of defer to you guys on that.
Yeah, I mean, you could definitely do, we showed an activity earlier where we used a seesaw to have students share their thinking with each other and then also with their parents. And then Michelle showed a lesson where she used Scratch Junior to have them code different ways to problem solve. So those would be great activities you could use if you have technology in the library.
I think that'd be great. I guess just to add on to that, finding ways for the older ones to feel empowered to help the younger ones, that's always a nice way of including.
Yeah, we have been on that, or quite a bit, on the Ames Buddy Project on the first PPLS, and that was pairing older grades with the younger grades. So you can look that up on PBS Learning Media as well.
Or even having the older ones read with the younger ones and ask each other questions. Maybe get some reading buddies together, like the AIM Project. I think that would be really powerful, especially in a library. My gosh, reading buddies are my favorite.
Love that.
I think we are out of questions. Is there anything else, Alexandra, that you'd like to share?
I will just tease some other episode content that's coming out that might be of interest to you guys in the classroom. One is not so fun, but unfortunately, we've just been hearing so much about emergency drills happening in schools. So we talked a little bit earlier about the communication we've been having with teachers and asking them what they could use, and that came up. So we are doing a fire drill episode in Daniel's classroom. As well as, this one's a little bit more silly, but a potty accident. We don't quite go there, but we have Prince Wednesday spill yellow paint on his pants, which is kind of a stand-in for the other thing, and showing that a teacher usually has a change of clothes in a preschool classroom, and that episode is actually encouraging telling the truth. So it's always coming forward and asking a grown-up for help rather than trying to hide an accident.
That's great. One last question, very important question. Their students want to know why Daniel doesn't wear pants and the other characters do.
Oh, the age-old question, why Daniel doesn't wear pants. I can't answer that. We'll have to keep the mystery alive.
It's top secret.
I think the most confusing thing, I will even admit, is that he does wear pajama pants and he does wear bathing suit shorts. So, I don't know.
Well, we really appreciate you taking the time to answer all of our questions. It's been such a joy to learn so much more about what you guys do. Thank you for everything.
My pleasure.
Oh, it was amazing. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Great. We want to thank